much for the introduction and for the invitation to come. I also need to note that I am currently a visiting Erskine Fellow at the University of Canterbury, so I have not come all the way from the U.S. just for this presentation. I need to start with a few disclaimers. So first of all, some of the opinions in here, all of the opinions in here are my own and not that of either the University of Canterbury or Utah State University, my home institution. And I am not directly involved in any research projects related to Flint, Michigan. But, as was mentioned in the bio, I've been researching drinking water treatment plants and water distribution systems for more than 20 years. So what I'm going to tell you is my distillation of the Flint story based on news articles, reports, peer-reviewed literature, as well as talking with some primary sources, including Dr. Mark Edwards at Virginia Tech. You'll hear more about him later in my talk. He was my postgrad advisor. I've continued to collaborate with him on many projects and certainly talked with him about the Flint situation. So the overall summary of what happened in Flint, I'll just read. I know you're not supposed to read from slides, but Flint water customers were needlessly and tragically exposed to toxic levels of lead and other hazards through the mismanagement of their drinking water supply. That's a pretty astounding statement. Now, if you heard about this in the news, you may have seen things like this. This is one of the most famous pictures from Flint. Those are water samples that came out of someone's tap at their house. Clearly not palatable water, and in fact, definitely not potable water either. Picture of a drinking fountain indicated to have high lead. Where we ended up was an entire community using bottled water for all of their drinking water needs. Cooking, washing, bathing, everything, they're using bottled water. So a short history of Flint. It is up in the upper Midwest of the United States in the state of Michigan. It's surrounded by the Great Lakes, which is a bit ironic with all that fresh water surrounding them. Flint was originally known as a GM town. General Motors is an automobile manufacturer in the US, and during their heyday, they employed a lot of people in really well-paying blue-collar jobs. In the early 1900s or 1980s, there were 200,000 people living in Flint. But then the economy went through several cycles, the auto manufacturers had some hard times, and now Flint is down to less than half of that. They have fewer than 100,000 people living in the city now. 57% of the residents identify as Black or African American, so it is a majority-minority population, and 42% of them are in poverty, so we do have some income inequality issues. Several times, Flint has been listed as the most dangerous city in America based on crime statistics. So where this story really starts is in 2011, we were coming out of the Great Recession in the US, and lots of cities were having financial difficulties. So Flint entered what we call receivership. It's similar to going into bankruptcy. The real crux of that is that the state of Michigan appointed a series of emergency managers to run the town. So they're no longer represented by their democratically elected mayor and council. There's this emergency manager that makes all the decisions. And one of those decisions then was to join what we call the KWA, the Kerangondi Water Authority. So just a bit more history. So this is Michigan, city of Flint here. Flint bought their water wholesale from Detroit for 50 years, okay? So Detroit treats water from Lake Huron and then wholesales it to Flint. But that was getting pretty expensive, and so as a cost savings measure, the city decided that they were going to join with the KWA. There was going to be a new water pipeline built to bring water to Flint and other communities. The problem is, that pipeline was not going to be finished for a couple of years. And so in April 2014, Flint, as an interim measure, started treating water from the Flint Flint River, which runs through town. So this is a completely different water source than what they'd been getting before. And pretty much chaos ensued. And when I say that, it started within a couple of weeks. People were complaining about discolored water, taste and odor. This is a picture of some water coming out of a sink in a hospital. These are some pipes that were later extracted, and you can see those different scales that have built up inside the pipes. There were also numerous complaints about skin rashes. So to compensate, they increased their chlorine residual. That took care of the pathogens, but then they were violating the limits on their disinfection byproducts. So they've hopefully got the pathogens under control, but now they've got these carcinogenic trihalomethanes. At one point, General Motors stopped using tap water because it was too corrosive to their water parts in their manufacturing plant. Now, despite all this, this story was not making national news. People in Flint certainly knew about it, maybe some people in Michigan, but it was really just another story of, oh, sad town, loss of infrastructure. And then came the lead results. So it really started with a woman named Leanne Walters. She was concerned about her children's health. One of her sons had been tested as having high lead in his blood. She was trying to figure out what was going on. So EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, sampled the water in her house and found high lead, but she wasn't getting the answers she wanted. So she contacted Dr. Mark Edwards at Virginia Tech. He's a noted expert in lead corrosion, and asked for his help in getting questions answered about lead in her water. So Mark and his students got together and actually sent out about 300 sampling kits to homeowners in Flint. This is a screenshot from their blog. It's called the Flint Water Study. They, at this point, had analyzed 252 of the samples. And interesting, this is just about 2 years ago that they did this announcement. And they're pointing out that Flint has a very serious lead problem. So 40% of the samples were above 5 parts per billion. They had samples that were at 100, even 1,000 parts per billion. The highest sample they measured was 13,200 parts per billion. That was actually in Leanne Walters' house, the woman who first contacted them about getting her lead or getting her water sample. And just for reference, in the U.S., the Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, sets an action limit at 15 parts per billion. The World Health Organization and here in New Zealand, the max acceptable value, it's 10 parts per billion. But really, the important thing to emphasize is there is no safe level of lead. This is well known, documented by multiple public health agencies like Centers for Disease Control, WHO. Lead is a very potent neurotoxin. It can cross the blood-brain barrier. Once it gets in the brain, it just wreaks all sorts of havoc. It's linked to decrease in IQ, behavioral issues, no end of problems. So just about a month after Mark and his students released those lead results, a pediatrician named Mona Hannah Atisha released levels of lead in children's blood. And so the graph here, this is a summary from their paper, we're looking at the percentage of children who test for high lead. And the colors here, the pre is back when they were using Detroit water. And then the post is after they had switched to the Flint River. So when they look at communities outside of Flint, that's actually not a statistically significant difference. But children living in Flint, the percent went from 2.5% to almost 5% of children had high lead levels in their blood. And when you look at the WLL, that's houses with high water lead levels, so high lead in their water, almost 11% of the kids tested as having high lead in their blood. And again, there is no safe level of lead. So continuing on our timeline here, this was April 2014, that they first switched over. 18 months later, the city of Flint realized this was not working, and they went back to buying Detroit water. But by then, the damage had been done, the pipes were corroded, and so in December 2015, the mayor of Flint declared a state of emergency. The utility issued a do not use order for the shortly thereafter that, in January 2016, President Obama mobilized FEMA, that's our Federal Emergency Management Agency, as well as the National Guard, to help deliver bottled water to the 100,000 people that live in Flint. Now, very pointedly, though, President Obama did not declare a national disaster, or a natural disaster, excuse me, because this was not something from Mother Nature, like the hurricanes and the fires that we've been seeing lately. This was purely human-caused. And so, the result, the estimates are that approximately 8,000 children in Flint have been exposed to high lead levels. There were 12 deaths from Legionnaire's disease, from exposure to the Legionella bacteria. A recent estimate put the social costs, so that's things like increased use of social services, decreased productivity, that sort of thing, at almost $400 million. But some estimates go as high as $1.5 billion for this situation to do everything like supply the bottled water, replace all the lead pipes, and so on. The really important long-term consequence of this is there was a complete loss in trust in government at all levels, local, state, and federal level. And this has made it a lot harder for Flint to recover from this situation, because now, even when people are getting good advice about how to fix their water, they don't believe it, and so they're not going to do anything. And even today, Flint residents are advised to filter their water before they use it for cooking or drinking. It should be safe for bathing, but not for cooking and drinking. And honestly, because of the previous point, a lot of people are still using 100% bottled water. They just don't trust the tap water. Just a bit of the technical as to why this happened. The plant was woefully unprepared to treat their water. They had not run this treatment plant full time in more than 50 years. So their treatment plant operators were not up to date on their training. They didn't have all the right equipment. They didn't have enough supplies of chemicals. And they were really just testing out coagulant doses and other chemicals on a trial and error basis at the full scale, trying to figure out how to treat this water. And the Flint River water is much more corrosive than the water they had been getting from Detroit. So the New York Times put together a nice little graphic here comparing Detroit water to Flint River water. So chloride is an indicator of how corrosive a water is to iron piping in the distribution system. And Detroit had a pretty low chloride, about 11 milligrams per liter. Flint River was almost 100 milligrams per liter chloride. And then looking at the chloride to sulfate mass ratio, that's an indicator of how corrosive the water is to lead plumbing and fixtures. So above 0.5 on that ratio of chloride to sulfate, we consider that corrosive to lead. Detroit water was just below that. Flint River water was at 1.6, so definitely in that range of highly corrosive. Despite this increased corrosivity, they were not adding any corrosion inhibitor to their water. So I know there's a lot of words on here, but I think this is a really important part of the story, so bear with me. There are three engineers in the room. Okay? There's the plant laboratory supervisor, there's a consulting engineer, and then an engineer from Department of Environmental Quality, that's the state regulatory agency. So the plant guy says, well, how often do we need to check for phosphate in our water? And the guy from the state says, you don't need to monitor phosphate because you're not required to add it. Recalling the meeting, he said he was taken aback by this. His gaze shifted to the consulting firm engineer, who also looked surprised. Then we went on to the next question. And that is really the crux, because 18 months passed and that water was corroding their pipes. So these are three engineers who absolutely should have known better, and maybe did know better, but didn't say anything. Well, it turns out that they were among the first to actually be charged with criminal charges in this case. Later, six more employees were charged with a variety of things. And then two of the former emergency managers, as well as two other people at the public health agency, have been charged with felony charges in this case. course, because this happened in the U.S., there are lawsuits on top of lawsuits. The residents are suing EPA, that's the federal agency. The state is suing the consulting companies who were supposed to provide them engineering advice. There's been a federal lawsuit filed. There's a counter lawsuit from someone who got fired and is now saying they were a whistleblower and shouldn't have been fired. And there's a class action lawsuit with hundreds of people signed up now, trying to get some redress here. All right, so terrible, terrible situation. But we don't want to just stop and leave it at that, because that would be a shame. So what can we hopefully learn from this situation? Well, I'm an academic, so I'm going to put this lesson first, and that is that academic research does not have to be purely academic. And really, in engineering, you know, we can often do a better job at this, but when Mark Edwards and his Virginia Tech team were contacted by that woman in Flint, they jumped right on it. And so the research we do at universities can really have a real-world impact with the people that we're helping. And we can do a great job as academics partnering with citizens to turn them into citizen scientists. This is a picture from the Flint Water Study. They actually just did a press conference last week showing some of the local citizens who didn't know anything about water chemistry or science or engineering, but worked with the university people and got empowered so that they could understand what was going in their water. I also really believe that we do need to credit the people who stepped up. I know it seems sort of cliche, but one person can make a difference. And in this case, there were several people who made a difference on the bad side of things, but also several people who made a difference on the good side. And so first, the two that I've mentioned already, Mark Edwards and Mona Hanna-Attisha, she was the pediatrician who did the blood lead study. And then the whole Flint research team, they've got dozens of undergraduates, postgrads, postdocs, other faculty involved there at Virginia Tech. I didn't have time to talk about this guy, Miguel del Toro, but he works for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and he was one of the first people at that federal level to really blow the whistle and say there's something not right with what's going on in Flint here. And we also need to credit the Flint citizens who were prepared. Leanne Walters was that woman who first contacted Virginia Tech looking for answers to why her water looked like that. And Melissa Mays was another. And then the Flint citizens who got organized and went to public meetings and protested at the state capitol and helped out their neighbors. They all deserve credit for helping to solve this problem. Government has to be accountable. And I know this seems like a no-brainer, but the technical errors in this situation were horribly compounded by some really bad decisions at the government level. For example, state workers in Michigan were getting bottled water, even though they were telling the residents of Flint it was okay to drink the tap water. Similarly, state officials knew that they had high levels of Legionella. They also knew that they had high levels of lead. They didn't tell people. And not only that, they actively worked against the people who were trying to figure this out. The other lesson is environmental injustice is real. This is an uncomfortable thing for us to think about, but would this situation have happened in a predominantly white, wealthy community? Probably not. And that's a really important lesson for us to ponder. It's not just Flint. Now, in the US, here in New Zealand, obviously, our water systems are good. By and large, we have good water, we have good people doing it. But we have infrastructure issues that need to be addressed. And we need to tell people about the value of clean water. It's a bit funny in our field, we almost want people to take us for granted, right? We want them to open up the tap in the morning and not think twice about it. And that's good, because it means we're delivering a good, safe product. But people need to know that it doesn't happen on its own. It takes a lot of work, it takes good engineering, and it takes money. So there was a recent survey that said that 95% of Americans want public officials to invest in water systems and 60% want to pay more. It was sponsored by the Value of Water Coalition, so that might be a bit biased, but it's a good sign, okay? It's a good sign. And then finally, we need to get serious about teaching ethics. There were some technical errors made in this case, but there were also some very serious ethical lapses. In the US, we are governed by American Society of Civil Engineers. Our code of ethics has 8 canons. The very first one, engineers shall hold paramount the safety, health, and welfare of the public. Here in New Zealand, IPENS has a very similar code of ethical conduct, and the first obligation is take reasonable steps to safeguard health and safety. Now, we need to do a better job of teaching our students, but there's only so much we can do with case studies while they're students. Those of you who are out there in the real world need to also commit to talking about the code of ethics, mentoring your new employees. By and large, people are good and they're going to do the right thing, but we all can benefit from that added confidence of knowing that our actions are grounded in a good ethical conduct. So there's just a few references. I can get copies of this to people if they want it. And with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Donick Mukuzo from Kaipra Council. What I wanted to find out is with regards to the water, the processing after they went to the Flint processing system, how did it get passed to actually say that this water is good for human consumption?
Yeah, so that was one of the ethical lapses that happened. That water should not have been sent out to the customers. There were failures at the local level at the treatment plant, as well as the state and federal level. It shouldn't have gone out as it did. And that, why those people made those decisions, that I don't have the answer for, but they were not properly treating the water, is the bottom line. Yeah, so that's kind of the great mystery about the situation.
Andrew Watson from Becker, thank you very much, and great paper. How common is lead piping still in the US? How is it particularly in the Midwest and the older towns with crumbling infrastructure? Can you give us a picture of that?
Yep, so unfortunately lead piping as well as lead fixtures are very common in the US. There are tens of thousands of lead service lines still remaining in communities. The older the community, the more likely they are to have lead. It was 1978 that we stopped using lead service lines, but it wasn't until the 1990s that our lead-free rule actually meant you could still have 8% lead in fixtures, and that was considered lead-free. So there is a lot of lead still remaining. It's an enormous cost burden to think about replacing all of it.
Jamie Bartram, University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. We're one of the groups, you know, that have done some of that other work on lead in the US, and it is a massive problem. It's a massive problem also in non-reticulated private systems.
Yes.
So that's for information for others. Every time I hear the story of Flint, what strikes me is that the most important thing we need to learn from it is how to make sure there's not another Flint. And the tendency is to look at the experience of Flint and relate it to Flint, rather than look at it and relate it to the system which should have prevented that ever happening. And it strikes me that many countries worldwide have procedures for environmental impact assessments which are activated by any major change relating to management of the environment. And it strikes me as extremely odd that we do not have an equivalent health impact assessment for any major change in the provision of a basic service on which human health is absolutely reliant. And I know that's partly a comment, but I'd love to hear your response to it.
All I can say is I agree 100%. And that's part of, I worry that people look at Flint and say, oh, it was such a poor community, or it was a minority community, or they weren't investing, and that's why this happened. Because, I mean, that is partly why it happened, but there are a lot of other systems out there that are potentially at risk. And in the US, EPA is revising our lead and copper rule. I think that's a good start, but your comment about doing some sort of public health assessment is also a good one. We are the government, though, right? It's made up of people. And so those of us, not me, but those of you who work in public government, I guess that's your charge from this, is to think about how to do that more effectively. We out of time?
That's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.